I'm Jeremy Allaire, and welcome to The Money Movement, a show where we explore the issues and ideas in this brave new world of digital currency and blockchains. So 2020 was an enormous year in crypto, and it was obviously incredible growth across the board in crypto assets on the whole. But I think, you know, a defining theme that drove so much of both the innovation and economic opportunity in the space was driven by DeFi. And in particular, you know, what sort of sparked a lot of this was the rapid growth in Compound Protocol and the launch of the Comp governance token, which sparked, you know, kind of enormous growth in the entire category of decentralized protocols for financial market infrastructure. So I think a year ago, I took a look and there was about $800 million in value locked in DeFi smart contracts. And today that's mushroomed to around $23 billion, give or take. But this is obviously just the start of a mega trend that will eventually upend, I think, multi-trillion dollar capital markets. So previously had Robert Leshner on the show, and we talked about, you know, DeFi. We talked about the sort of concepts of programmable money and what people can do with stablecoins and smart contracts. Recently, there was a really cool editorial from former OCC interim head Brian Brooks, who talked about this idea of self-driving banks. And I really liked it. So part of the title this week is sort of DeFi and self-driving banks, but this sort of concept here is like self-driving cars, where automotive machines are sort of governed and operated entirely in software, and how that poses new challenges for how people think about risk, how people think about rules, how people think about a lot of things. DeFi in many ways really is this kind of similar thing, but in what banks do, self-driving banks. So fundamental building blocks of finance are governed and operated entirely by machines and software on the internet, which is super exciting. So joining us this week is repeat guest, Compound founder and CEO, Robert Leshner. We're gonna explore this mega trend, what 2021 will bring in DeFi. And then I think a long-term view, I wanna talk a little bit about the sort of transformation of capital markets that's on our doorstep as we explore this. Welcome back, Robert.
Thanks, Jeremy. Great to be here.
Awesome. So maybe we can just start, and I'm sure you're sick of this, but just, you know, talk about the last year for Compound. It's just been incredible, but maybe give us a couple minutes on what's happened. It's staggering and super impressive. So congrats as well.
Thank you. So Compound is a protocol for users to earn an interest rate on crypto assets and borrow crypto assets against them. Most popularly, users are using crypto collateral to borrow stable coins. And the system has been running for a couple of years, but in 2020, what we did is we transitioned Compound from being a series of smart contracts that are overseen by humans and centralized humans at that, our company being the ones responsible to oversee the protocol, to transitioning the protocol to decentralized community governance. So allowing the entire crypto community at large the opportunity to upgrade the computer code that runs Compound and to be able to collaboratively set the different parameters of the markets. So Compound is now running as a decentralized protocol on a blockchain. It's a financial market that, you know, doesn't need any one person in order to run it. It can run independent of the original team, and it can ideally run for the next century. It's autonomous, and these markets will hopefully operate forever.
So unlike self-driving cars that maybe need to go to a charging station, This, as long as like the internet's running and I guess, you know, people are validating blocks, you know, on these compute engines, like it will just run as a self-driving bank.
Yeah, the best way to sort of explain it is, you know, this started off as, you know, a mostly autonomous vehicle, right? Where it, you know, there was a driver, you know, behind the wheel just in case something went wrong. And that was, you know, Compound Labs, the team that built it. Nothing ever really went wrong. It didn't require too much touching of the steering wheel. And we've replaced the human driver with internet hive mind.
Dead people in Phoenix yet.
Not yet, you know? So, you know, now there's, you know, essentially a self-driving vehicle. And when, you know, the steering wheel needs to be touched, there's, you know, an internet, you know, collective. And so, you know, with this structure, you know, it is essentially autonomous. And all of the logic of how the markets work and how balances function, it's all computed, you know, using these computer programs.
So there's a lot going on there. And I think to the uninitiated, it's sort of like, what? Like, what are you talking about? Like, what do you mean? I mean, there's a lot I want to explore here. And maybe, you know, maybe first actually is, you know, the sort of functions that a bank might provide, traditional intermediation in borrowing and lending, as an example, you know, just to talk through a little bit of, you know, they're sort of where Compound is today, but, you know, what are all of the different dimensions of intermediation that you think can be self-driving, that can be entirely machine operated and governed in this space? And obviously we see a lot of building blocks, composability, et cetera, that's out there today. But when you think about the primitives that you're working on and kind of compare that against interest rate markets or other things, like how do you see that?
Yeah, it's a great question. So, you know, fundamentally, Compound allows, you know, two different counterparties to participate in a financial market. One side is earning an interest rate, and the other is using collateral to borrow assets and paying an interest rate. And there's so many functions that would exist in a sort of traditional bank just to create this
right
economic function. You would have, you know, people, you know, building systems to accept funds from one group of users, right? This is like the liability side of it. Sure. Where, you know, you're building
and payment systems that go into that and so on. You just ride on stable coins and crypto assets. Yeah,
exactly. Like there'd be so many pieces of work in order just to accept funds from users. And with Compound, you know, it's purely crypto there. And all of the rules for the transfer and settlement of cryptographic assets are defined, you know, on a blockchain. And that part is completely, you know, abstracted away. And there's no humans necessary really for that. Users administer their own transfer of funds and the settlement of it. The record keeping for that is also, you know, autonomous and stripped away. The entire history of transactions is transparent and accessible on the blockchain. You know, you don't need, you know, all sorts of like bookkeepers to reconcile it. Like,
yeah,
always reconciled basically in real time as users submit transactions. Anyone can audit or inspect the state of the records and can see, you know, how we got to the current books. Mm-hmm. And so that's, you know, completely abstracted away. Then you have, you know, the calculation of, you know, balances. And like, if users are earning an interest rate, you know, traditionally you would also have entire systems of record. You would have entire banking, you know, databases and, you know, software packages for that economic behavior. With a system like Compound, it's all encapsulated just in, you know, very simple, you know, code running on a blockchain. And there's no humans necessary. When it comes to the other side, which is people borrowing assets, this is where you would have huge quantities of, you know, operations, systems, and people involved in a traditional organization. You would have the evaluation of collateral. You would have the communication with customers. You would have the transfer of collateral and the transfer of, you know, borrowed funds. You would have, you know, nonstop reconciliation. You would have, you know, massive, you know, systems, let alone when, you know, market conditions change and, you know, the value of the collateral changes. In a system, you know, running on a blockchain like Compound, all of that is replaced with smart contracts where, you know, it basically strips away all of the steps that would fail if the humans mess up or if the software messes up, or if, you know, people don't show up to work one day. And all of these systems of analyzing collateral, you know, monitoring the market risk of them, you know, enforcing liquidity requirements and risk requirements, all of that that would take teams of humans
right.
is replaced with a computer program. We call them smart contracts,
right.
But a computer program running on a blockchain that anyone can inspect, you know, everyone can see the rules of the program, how it operates, that it's operating, that it's working correctly, right. and can see that, you know, instead of needing scores of people and databases and records and spreadsheets, you know, it can all be done with a computer program.
It's obviously super exciting. If you look at traditional banks, right, there's some fundamental differences. You've outlined a lot of those that have to do with human intermediation and sort of this and how the counterparties themselves, the kind of experience that they're going to have. I think, one of the things that comes to mind is, you know, the effectively risk management, you know, is such a huge part of what a bank does. And bank examiners, if you like go get the OCC bank examiners manual and you look at, you know, what that's about, like an enormous amount of it is like, capital, liquidity, risk management, underwriting, like all this sort of stuff, like these incredible amounts of things there. And so, you know, in this world, one obviously major difference is, you know, this is all, you know, it's all managed in software, right? And so if I were a bank examiner in the quote unquote self-driving bank world, like I'm going to basically be examining the smart contracts and examining how effective they are. And they're kind of incontrovertible, right? By definition. And it seems like another major difference here is Compound can't create money. It does not have the ability to create money. Banks do create money. They say, I have this collateral, I have this assets, and I'm going to create commercial deposits with it. I'm going to basically create money. And so crypto obviously is a sort of full reserve system. Do you think that particular dimension, credit creation, how do you think about that relative to the way that these sort of nascent capital markets exist in crypto? Is there an equivalency there somewhere that can take place? What does that look like?
It's a great question. So, you know, traditionally banks, you know, in effect, you know, increase the money supply by lending out money, which then becomes a deposit in another bank or their own bank. There are similar principles, even with crypto assets, where there's a finite supply. So take Bitcoin as an example. Everyone knows that there's going to be 21 million Bitcoin, but, you know, Bitcoin also can be moved onto other blockchains and tokenized in new ways. So a great example of this is an asset called Wrapped Bitcoin. So the custodian BitGo holds a bunch of Bitcoin. I think it's like 110,000 Bitcoin. It's a lot at this point. And they issue a token on the Ethereum blockchain called Wrapped Bitcoin so that users on Ethereum can send Bitcoin, interact with DeFi protocols like Compound, you know, add programmable logic to Bitcoin on Ethereum. And in effect, you know, you can see the ledger of Bitcoin. If there's only ever going to be 21 million, you can see the location of all of those Bitcoin. But right. 110,000 of them are held in BitGo, and they've issued a token on Ethereum against them. And they, in effect, you know, you could say have increased the total quantity of Bitcoin with this transformation. Although, you know, the original 110,000 are just
model. It's always there. Yeah.
It's always there and they're not moving. And if it were to move, you know, everyone would, you know, scream bloody murder.
Air on fire. More. Yeah.
They basically, in effect, said there's still the same 21 million Bitcoin, but they're usable on Ethereum.
Yeah.
And on Ethereum, in effect, you know, through a system like Compound, you know, the number of people who believe that, you know, they hold Bitcoin can also increase, you know. A user might borrow wrapped Bitcoin, you know, from a system like Compound, and that user has wrapped Bitcoin and somebody else you know, has supplied it and believes, you know, and does own the claim to that wrapped Bitcoin. And so through, you know, decentralized finance, you know, you can see, you know, how an asset can spread throughout an ecosystem. There is in effect a little bit of this, you know, multiplicative effect on assets. But that's through finance in general. If I were to, you know, lend Jeremy, you know, my car, I would say I own one car and Jeremy would have a car, right? Even if later he's going to give return my car to me, you know, after the weekend road trip.
There's like a, you know, obviously like a, there's a lot of dimensions to this, and I'm really curious about how you think about, and I'll come back later to a little bit to kind of tokenization of assets more broadly and how that flows to DeFi. And we're already starting to see that, and we'll see a lot more of it, but very specifically, you know, Compound Protocol today, right? It's secured lines of credit, you know, essentially, right? It's entirely secured. It's over collateralized. And so it's safer, right? So we have a lot more comfort in terms of the risk management that goes along with that. And so I think the sort of value at risk models are safer just. But do you see a world of unsecured lending in the crypto, in DeFi specifically? It's almost conceptually, you know, challenging, but essentially, you know, people showing up and basically saying, I'll give you some USDC or I'll give you some wrapped BTC, and you're not giving me anything. And I guess the overlay question on that is, and I want to come back to this from a regulatory perspective too, but, you know, identity, reputation, how do you think about identity and reputation emerging and interacting with DeFi protocols? Because that really seems like the only way it gets us to unsecured lending.
So that's a great question. There's a lot there. So I'll start by going back to this sort of, you know, concept of autonomous banking. So the reason why a system like Compound works is because it's replacing, you know, what otherwise is a relatively simple, you know, banking function with code. So it's using fungible liquid assets as collateral to borrow against. Fungible assets are ones in which they all look and feel the same. You know, there's no nuance between one wrapped Bitcoin and another wrapped Bitcoin, or one Ether and another Ether. They're the exact same. Unlike two houses where each house is fundamentally different, or two borrowers that are fundamentally different. Compound relies on fungible collateral that's liquid. And so it's very easy to build a system that knows how to value that collateral and allow for the liquidation of that collateral. So it's very easy to build a system like Compound that requires excess collateral and liquid fungible collateral to borrow against. It's able to build a computer program that can administer this safely. It's why the very first DeFi applications are probably the simplest and the safest and probably perceived as the most conservative, right? Like what Compound creates is not, you know, very dangerous.
Right.
And it's easy to administer. Eventually, you know, teams will figure out how to replace human judgment with, you know, code running on a blockchain. But that's a significantly more challenging problem to replicate and replace. You know, it makes sense why the very first, you know, protocols like Compound are just taking the easiest, lowest hanging fruit problem.
But we're seeing that obviously today, like, right, you know, Max Levchin and Affirm just IPO'd today, or it was yesterday, I don't know what it was. It like doubled in price. It's an incredibly valuable company, but that's basically machine governed. It's AI. It's obviously, you know, deploying and computing AI on a blockchain is hard, but you can imagine, you know, through oracles and other means, like ways to, you know, have like highly automated machine governed decision, risk decisioning, right? But that's still sit inside of an underwriting smart contract that is, you know, interacting with some form of, you know, kind of verifiable, attested identity that's interacting with a smart contract.
Exactly. And so, you know, as you start to look at, you know, how do systems, you know, manage and take on credit risk, you know, Compound starts with like the lowest credit risk. You know, you're using, you know, a lot of liquid collateral to back something. The risk is extremely low. But as you start to move into, hey, this is, you know, an extension of credit based on someone's reputation or other data points or other parameters, it starts to increase risk. And really intelligent systems like Affirm or other can manage those risks and be extremely good at it. But as you start to extend the amount of risk, that's where I think you need to start to extend, you know, oversight and regulation of these systems. Because it's very possible that you have a bad parameter, you know, and you extend money to, you know, a huge swath of people that can never repay.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. I guess a follow-on question to that is, you know, how do you think about, and it ties into regulation. And again, it's a theme I want to come back to, but how do you think about decentralized identity models interacting with smart contract protocols like Compound. Do you see that emerging? What do you think that looks like?
So I think it's going to be slow to evolve because, I think it's one of the harder problems in the space. I do think, eventually, the market structure is going to evolve in general. It's going to be in which, there's large, products and institutions that are built on top of DeFi protocols and offer and are the on and off ramps to them. Mm-hmm. And those types of institutions are, phenomenal at standard and aggregating information, right? In a good way and a bad way about their users. Yeah. So I can actually identify.
Well, and they're actually required by law to do so as well. I mean, exactly. Some of it, yeah.
So I think as DeFi evolves, the sort of structure that will be in place is, you'll have DeFi protocols, which themselves are relatively dumb. It's hard to get lots of data into them. It's hard for them to do complex, decision-making. They're best equipped for very simple things. Mm-hmm. Things like we'll start to have a whole market structure built on top of them, exchanges that integrate these protocols, banks that integrate these protocols, institutions and wallets and prime brokers and hedge funds and all of these things on top of it that, over time will be able to provide identity and either, do it on behalf of their customers, where they're willing to take on risk of their users or, provide information to the rest of the network. But I think it's not going to sort of take place when we're living this DeFi structure where users interact with contracts directly. It's not ideal.
So this is, it's one of the places where the rubber meets the road in that, obviously, we saw news today, of course, that the, FinCEN has extended the notice and comment period for some of their rules around, institutions and their users interacting with, self-hosted wallets. One of the critical issues in that, which I commented on publicly, lots of other people did as well, which is that, as stated, it would make it impossible for a bank or a financial institution to enable its users or through its own software to enable its users to interact with, DeFi protocols, because what's the name and physical address of Compound protocol? There's no name and physical address. There's a contract on the Ethereum blockchain. Like, is that the address? Put that in my CTR. But in any case, clearly this is becoming an area that regulators are going to care about. And obviously the OCC guidance that came out last week and sort of giving banks permission to use stablecoins as a payment infrastructure, interact with public blockchains. We're just a step away from regulated financial intermediaries sort of embedding, DeFi into their infrastructure and enabling entities, i.e. individuals or firms, to interact with that. And so it does seem like between kind of the way that, regulators are trying to think about how do you kind of deal with record keeping and identity. And then, similarly, how does mainstream finance plug into this infrastructure? We're kind of triangulating on this. And it seems like we have to, those issues are going to kind of come to the fore faster than we realize, maybe.
They will. And, I personally think that there's a lot of properties of DeFi that make it extremely well suited for institutions and for regulators. There's a lot of virtues. So, the first is that, it's fair. The second is that it's transparent. The third is that there's less room for human error. These are all, virtues that I think both the institutions and the regulators want and see. It's better, primitives than what currently exists. Right now, most financial institutions keep their own records, right? When you're keeping your own records, that's where you can get into trouble of, sending money to the wrong place or the wrong person, or allowing someone to use your institution nefariously.
Right.
Every institution maintaining its own ledger and then interacting with other institutions, it's a structure that's ripe for disaster and intentional or inadvertent money laundering or abuse, which is why it has to be regulated so carefully.
Yeah.
Right. Versus an open ledger, like a blockchain, to conduct transactions and store value, it's like a huge blast of sunshine. And you won't necessarily have to regulate it in the exact same way. You won't need to regulate it in the exact same way, because it's almost, you know, going to be 1,000 times harder to use, you know, a DeFi system, you know, to launder money, or, you know, to use it nefariously. Just because, you know, you have a shared ledger where everybody sees all of the transactions and the state of the world. You know, it's very hard to lie about.
Like you said too, like, you know, like an institution facing another institution through an intermediary, like, you know, what is the counterparty risk? It's just like the fundamental inherent problem in the way that the much of the financial system is organized. And so it's just fundamentally about that, yeah, increasing transparency, reducing counterparty risk. Like, what institution doesn't want that? Who doesn't want to face a market where you're just systematically eliminating counterparty risk?
Right. In the existing market structure, every single institution has its own books and records.
Yeah.
And of course, they have to be inspected and audited and analyzed, because something can go wrong at any institution. And it does go wrong at many institutions constantly, versus, you know, using financial infrastructure where there's one set of books and records that everybody can see transparently and clearly. It's an order of magnitude better.
Yeah, and obviously zero knowledge proofs and privacy preserving technology will make it possible for people, for individuals and corporations to be able to kind of transact and not have their books and records be visible to everyone, but still actually have it be, you know, provable on chain, and still have an auditor or whoever it is be able to kind of look at that in an automated way.
Exactly.
Yeah. So the other thing just that came to mind is, like, you know, like, there's no such thing as a drunk self-driving car. And that's kind of like, you know, who's at the wheel. And if you have self-driving banks that have this automation and transparency, you don't have to worry about the human operator, which is maybe a good segue into this, I think, just enormous transformative shift that you made to comp the governance token, to really turning over quite literally the keys to what is the administration and operation and upgrading and ultimately governance of risk management, just, you know, kind of parameters. It's just really tremendous. One of the themes that I've been exploring, we did last week with Balaji as well, was, you know, these new corporate forms that are coming into existence. And, you know, I really look at the work that you guys have been pioneering. There's many others too, but you guys have been pioneering, which is, this is a new corporate form that exists entirely on the internet, entirely in software. Just talk a little bit about the inspiration for that, and then kind of how it's going, how it's operating, and maybe I have some follow-ups.
Yeah, so it's a great question, and thank you. So, you know, we chose to transition Compound from a system in which our team was able to upgrade the contracts as needed, to one in which anyone with the buy-in of the broader community can upgrade the contracts as needed. And this makes it so that, you know, one, our team can't mess it up accidentally or deliberately. I no longer worry about, you know, getting kidnapped because I have, you know, private keys. And two, by increasing the amount of people that are able to upgrade the system and maintain the system or the parameters, it leads to more and better ideas and, you know, a larger throughput of, you know, intelligence and work able to maintain the system. You know, instead of one person with their hands on the wheel, now there's a lot of people with their hands on the wheel. And this was a complex transformation. We were one of the first projects to really go from, you know, one party has decision-making to everybody has decision-making. And, you know, I think it's the sort of arc that many projects in the space will have, where, you know, when it's small and, you know, when it's not widely used and widely understood, there should probably be only one team working on something. Yeah. And as it starts to become widely used and you start to have a variety of, you know, businesses built on top of it that depend on and know how it works, it really doesn't, you know, function well to have one party still in control. When there's many stakeholders, you start to have a, you know, you need a higher standard of reliability and permanence. That by removing a single stakeholder from control, I think you can give to the community. So at this point, you know, everyone who uses Compound, you know, can have confidence knowing that if they need or want to make a change to it, there's a process which the community can make a change to the protocol. You know, it still requires the buy-in and the support of the broad ecosystem, but it's much more of like federated decision-making. And I think that's a really powerful model because, you know, at this point, you know, we can step away and the protocol will continue to function in perpetuity.
I think, you know, there's just so many interesting analogies, you know, like, you know, credit unions or community owned banks or, you know, whatever. And I'm coming back to this self-driving bank concept for a minute, which is, you know, the community ownership and governance is so powerful and it's truly global. And, you know, it doesn't require some really hairy multinational corporate thing with all kinds of international jurisprudence. It's just software and participants that can participate in that tokenized corporate form. You know, it's a pretty radical shift though, to go from like, there's a board of directors and a single corporation that makes decisions to the community as a whole. And this is, you know, one of the, I think, great laboratories of experimentation. You know, what has it been like to be community governed for whatever it's now been? I think it's over 6 months.
Yeah, so it's been quite an exciting 6 months. So one of the things that we did before the 6 months is we actually tested sort of like the mechanisms publicly with like a limited stakeholder group. So instead of there being one, you know, party, there was like 20, and now there's, you know, 20,000. But over the last, you know, 6 months, we've started to see some really exciting things. I mean, community to developers, just like folks who love Compound saying, I have an idea to make it slightly more efficient or to lower the gas costs of interacting with it or to, you know, add a new feature which will increase the safety of it. And, you know, I think that like it's opened up ideas that weren't possible just when one team was overseeing a protocol. And I think that's a real, you know, virtue and use case. The downside is that there's not one party in control. You know, there's not like one, you know, person leading it forward. It's been awkward that, you know, everyone sort of like always constantly, you know, looks back to me and says, well, Robert, what do you think we should do? And I say, I'm like number six on the list of stakeholders. You know, I have less of a voice than most users in the community at this point.
Sort of open source, you know, has, you know, wide variety of modes of governance, some formal, some informal, standard setting, same kind of thing. And so you're in that pool of experimentation, it feels like.
We are. And like, you know, most, you know, organizational structure over the last couple hundred years has evolved to like a pyramid like structure, right? Where there's one key decision maker that drives, you know, organizations and systems forward. And, you know, in crypto, we're, you know, really saying, well, it's not a corporation, right? It's a financial market that's going to run forever. That probably doesn't need too many modifications to it.
Yeah.
What's the best way to continue to drive it? And, you know, we really stepped back from the single decision maker approach and it's, you know, it's too early to say if it works or it doesn't work. You know, our original team is now just one developer amongst many, and we're actually working on a separate project, which can hopefully connect back to Compound. But it's really been interesting to just see like how folks are stepping up to become involved.
Yeah, it's amazing. The other piece to these sort of new corporate forms, and obviously Comp is related to this, which is economic incentives, right? So if I think of traditional equity, right, it's got votes and it's got dividends or whatever other features it may have, various coupons or whatever it is. And sort of these, you know, decentralized community governed protocols, it actually interacts with the underlying economics of the protocol itself, which is really a breakthrough, right? To be able to effectively enable that economic participation. You know, how has that been going? How's it been going for comp holders themselves? And, you know, sort of this deployment of the fee structure into that. It'd be great to hear you talk a little bit about some of those things.
Yeah, so to start off with, you know, one of the biggest experiments that we conducted, and now it, you know, is starting to emerge as like a trend within DeFi and crypto, but it really wasn't, you know, all of 6 months ago, is, you know, we've been distributing ownership and governance of the Compound protocol to the users of it. You know, it would be like if Nike, you know, gave a share of Nike, you know, stock to everyone who bought a pair of shoes. And everybody was able to sort of like set the future direction of Nike.
Yeah.
The reason why that isn't technologically possible is, you know, Nike doesn't have a way of officially transferring ownership to its customer base. But with a DeFi protocol like Compound that's already built on a blockchain, by definition, all of the users of it have crypto wallets and they're interacting with, you know, a piece of software. And so it's very straightforward and technologically possible for the first time for the protocol to very directly sort of like distribute ownership of itself to its users. And it wasn't technologically possible up until, you know, very recently.
Yeah.
So the things that are even possible for like a modern organization might evolve, right? Maybe Nike would have made every one of its shoe purchasers.
Not too late.
It's not too late, right? You know, buying it on a blockchain, right?
Yeah.
But
go ahead, sorry.
Yeah, it wasn't even technologically possible. So now it is. And so, you know, it's a very early experiment. You know, we're one of the first to try this. And, you know, we're starting, you know, there's still a couple of years left of distributing this ownership and control to users. But just like you can distribute the ownership directly to the users, the governance tokens can interact with the protocol in new and interesting ways.
Yeah.
You know, users can upgrade the protocol. They could change the economics of it. They could change the cash flows. I've actually been surprised, and this is actually one of the things I didn't anticipate. Since launching the comp distribution, there actually haven't been any proposals to send cash flows to the users in any way. And this actually surprised me because I actually assumed that the second that the users had, you know, governance, they'd say, the first thing we're going to do is pay ourselves. And like that actually hasn't happened. And I'm actually delighted by that. But I had assumed that the very first thing that people would say is we're going to pay ourselves from the protocol.
Yeah. Fascinating. Really, really fascinating. So a couple of things that this kind of connected to that I wanted to talk about too was, you know, the Nike example is an interesting one. You know, we own and operate Seed Invest, which is an equity crowdfunding platform, lets people directly sell equity, to individuals on the internet. And, you know, the rules for that are really expanding. And, you know, we had the SEC at the end of the year, you know, finally issue some clarity and guidance around how broker dealers can, you know, clear, custody, settle digital assets. So you kind of are seeing this opening where the sort of between kind of crowdfunding rules and SEC clarity on digital assets, where, you know, effectively like tokenized assets. And when we think of financial assets, I'm talking about equity in a corporation or a debt instrument or physical property or other things. Really, there's an opening for those things to happen now. How do you, you know, what role do you see for, you know, tokenized real world assets? Like if someone had a valid form of tokenized equity in a Nike or whatever, like, do you see Compound, you know, interacting with liquid markets in equity tokens, in physical asset tokens, in other things?
Yeah, the answer is, you know, I think, obviously, eventually there's going to be lots of digital assets that represent more and more often real world things.
Yeah.
You know, they represent stock in a business, or they represent a bond, or they represent currency, or they represent a house.
There's this currency thing called USDC I heard about.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's great. I love USDC. But I think there's going to be more and more assets like this administered on blockchains. And blockchains are a better place to administer any asset versus just in a database or using paper, right? It's has tremendous advantages for transparency and settlement and all these great things. So every asset will wind up on a blockchain.
Yep.
Whether or not all of those assets interact with something like Compound is, you know, a broad question and it's hard to understand, but will they interact with DeFi? Absolutely, right, in general. You know, Compound specifically relies on like very large liquid fungible assets where, you know, an early stage company stock probably isn't that, right? But, you know, the dollar tokenized is, or the yen tokenized is.
Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting. Like you look at like liquidity pools and AMMs in various decentralized markets. And I mean, markets exist for highly illiquid tokens. I mean, and in some ways, like there's ways to parameterize those markets to deal with the fact that, you know, these are highly illiquid, and you get someone who can stand in there and say, no, I'm going to stand in these trades to provide whatever that baseline of liquidity is. And I've always been interested in this idea that, you know, DeFi and in particular DeFi and blockchains will enable long tail capital markets, right? We have long tail advertising, we have long tail content, long tail everything, right? But long tail capital markets, where actually a illiquid, quote unquote, private company stock, or you know, a debt obligation of a farmer in a market somewhere in the world, all these things could actually have the ability to participate in markets like these.
Absolutely. And, you know, I think, you know, the quantity and type characteristics of different, you know, DeFi products that emerge will start to cater to that long tail, because it's all possible. You know, when you replace, you know, these systems with, you know, programmable ones, in which it's really the creativity of developers, the ingenuity of them to create new financial services and products sort of the barrier, like anything is possible. So I think eventually there will be, you know, assets like, you know, seed invest companies tokenized living on a blockchain that are able to interact with all new financial systems.
So it sort of ties into another question I wanted to get your thoughts about, which was, you know, this is inherently global. Anyone connected to the internet can participate. That's causing a lot of heartburn for national governments who are like, well, wait a minute. You know, we look over some of these things. Is this going to be a market? And I don't just mean about Compound, but I think about this more broadly. Is this going to be a market where, like, it's like 10x better, and society just says, we want this. And so, like, governments, you guys need to adapt, versus technology, you need to adapt to governments. Like, where do you think that, does that happen? Is this like, I hesitate to use these examples, but like Uber and Airbnb or Didi or Tencent, or, you know, these companies that make these 10x better products, and then society's just like, that's what I want, and the government needs to adapt? Or what do you see happening?
Well, I think we're already seeing where, you know, you're starting to see, you know, massive volume and massive interest in open financial products and services. And they truly are, in some ways, just categorically 10x better than existing financial market analogs, right? That comes with dangers and risks, right? Like, you know, is a self-driving bank a good thing? Yes. Is it dangerous? Of course. Is the very first one even more dangerous?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Right. But over time, would we rather have, you know, extremely advanced autonomous financial markets that are open to everybody, that are transparent, that are cheap, that are fast, that are, you know, 100% gross margin? Absolutely. So I think society will pull us towards there. And I think at the end of the day, the benefits of, you know, enabling this technology will shine through. I think regulators will over time embrace this for the amount of innovation that it can unlock. Yeah. There's obviously risks, and there's obviously, you know, dangers, right? At the end of the day, everybody wants to, you know, protect retail investors, which is a good thing. And everyone wants to prevent nefarious activity, right? And, you know, DeFi done correctly, you know, is a massive, massive net benefit for retail investors.
Yeah.
From, you know, from the cost of banking to the cost of investment to, you know, everything else, massive net benefit for
retail. I would see that with stablecoins. Obviously, like, you know, our ultimate mission here is like ubiquitous value exchange at no cost on the internet, right? And like, who doesn't want that? Any person, any business, anywhere. So we're certainly moving there.
And they want it for good reason, right? And it's like, it's extremely important. It's just so much better and easier than what they're used to. And so I think it's like, you know, a market that's a virtuous one for, you know, the public. And it's not a great system for, you know, abuse. Like, traditional financial markets are so much better, you know, for nefarious activity, you know, cash is from the fairness.
Right. You know, opacity and all that. So I'm going to end with a sort of two-part question. The first is obviously, like, you know, stablecoins and USDC play a significant role in the DeFi ecosystem, and certainly with Compound. And so we've enjoyed, you know, the collaboration and seeing that, you know, so just first, just like, you know, kind of high level comments on what you see in terms of, you know, the role of stablecoins in DeFi. And then I have a follow-up question.
Yeah, well, stablecoins are, you know, one of the first real killer apps in DeFi, in my opinion. You know, the reason being that, you know, DeFi, you know, it's two words combined, decentralized and finance, but the real word is finance, right? Like, you know, people like to conduct financial transactions in a currency they're familiar with and they understand, which is why stablecoins have become sort of like the bedrock of decentralized finance. It's much easier to conduct, you know, a financing activity or a trade or anything when it comes with predictable value. So stablecoins are a killer use case there. And I think it's sort of obvious why. And I think they'll continue to be. You know, I think it's possible that what is a stablecoin starts to evolve. You know, we're going to possibly see other currencies. You know, in crypto, we might see central bank issued currencies. There's a lot of different directions that this might evolve. But I think at the end of the day, people will continue to sort of like mentally, you know, rely on stable coins for finance.
Yeah, we agree. So last question, I like to ask guests various predictions. So so I'm gonna ask you, so obviously, you know, USDC grew 800% last year. So, and it ended the year literally on December 31st around midnight at 4 billion USDC. It's already increased by 900 million in the first 2 weeks. So it's growing. You know, TVL, you know, 800 million to 23 billion. What do you think? End of 2021, USDC in circulation and total value locked in DeFi.
So I'm bad at these games. So whatever I say, just discount it heavily. You know, I would say we'll probably end 2021 at about $60 to $70 billion in DeFi. You know, I think the rate of growth will decline a little bit, but the numbers will be staggering still.
Yeah, that's big.
So, you know, I'll put my money at 60. And I think USDC will probably be at about 15.
15. All right. Consensus seems to be consolidating around 15 to 20.
You know, I could be way off, so it'll be fun. You know, maybe awesome. I'm, you know, getting anchored there, but
awesome. Robert, thank you so much for joining us today. It's great to have you. We'll certainly have you again and look forward to the continued collaboration.
Thanks for having me on. Thanks, Jeremy.
Cheers. Bye-bye. So exciting, exciting times in stablecoin land, DeFi land, self-driving banks. Things are moving along very, very quickly here. So really exciting to see and looking forward to next week. Until next time, stay well, stay safe, and stay informed.